Sometimes the scriptures that are picked for the Sundays kind of drop us right down into the middle of the story. And I think that's kind of true today with the story of Joseph. The Old Testament and the New Testament, while they look like two different sections, are really one work. They are one narration of how God is getting us to the kingdom. Now, it's taking over 4,000 years to have this done, but it's one narration. And it's kind of neat to go back and review all the steps that come up to the story for today, because there's all kinds of things in the story for today that have reference back to things that happened before, such like this. We know Abraham. Abraham was married to Sarah, and Sarah could not bear a child. So she gave Abraham her maidservant, an Egyptian slave girl named Hagar, to be his second wife. And with her, she bore a son, and they named him Ishmael. After a while, through the blessings of God, Sarah bore a son. They called him Isaac. And as the boys grew up, Ishmael was kind of mean to Isaac, and that got Sarah's anger up big time, even because Hagar was making fun of Sarah when she couldn't bear a son and was teasing her about it, and that got her going. But this was the end of it, and she said to Abram, get rid of this slave woman, get her and that kid out of here. And so he did, packed them up and pushed them off into the desert. Well, God appeared to her and said, now wait, your son, Ishmael, will become a nation as well as will Isaac. So I will take care of you. And she went off into Egypt and found him a wife from the Egyptians. And so these two, while they're half-brothers, they're stayed there separated. Well, the next part of the story is that Isaac goes out and he gets married to a girl by the name of Rebekah. And Rebekah has twins, Esau and Jacob. Interesting part of this is that Esau is born first, and he should be the firstborn, and Jacob comes out the womb second, and he should be not the firstborn. However, he usurps himself and gets him in the progression of the promise. The promise from God to Abraham follows down now to Jacob. You notice how different things are there. That first of all, Abraham can have two wives. And now when we come to Jacob, Jacob goes out because Isaac says to him, you will find a wife back home. You will get a wife from where we lived, where our ancestors are. You will not take a wife from these people with whom we live now. So he went. Jacob went. And he comes along and he finds a man by the name of Laban. Now, Laban is Rebekah's brother. He's his uncle. And amongst his children is a girl by the name of Rachel. And he falls in love with her immediately. He goes to Laban and he says, I will work for you for 7 years if you will give me Rachel as a wife. Well, he works the 7 years, and I think we heard that story last week or the week before. Old Laban sticks in Leah, the firstborn girl, and puts her in as his wife, to his chagrin. He said, whoa, wait a minute. I wanted Rachel. Well, if you work for me another 7 years, I'll give you Rachel also. So in the meantime, with these two girls, they also gave Jacob their maidservants to be wives also. So now he got four wives. That's unheard of too in our society, isn't it? At any rate, the boys are growing. The children of these three women are growing, and Rachel cannot bear a child. It's very, very difficult for her to bear a child. And all of a sudden, through the grace of God, she bears a child to Abraham, to Jacob. And they call him Joseph. Well, he really loves Joseph because he's from his wife Rachel, favorite wife, and he's born in his old age. And he treats him very nicely. He gives him this long coat. The scripture says a coat with sleeves. And also uses the word a striped coat, which makes them come to forth. I heard the story about the coat of many colors. If it's striped, I guess it's got many colors. But it doesn't say many colors in the scripture. But at any rate, it's really a symbol of great authority and great love. And the older boys take it harshly. Not only that, little Joseph now is blessed by the Lord with some dreams. Interesting in the scriptures about dreams. And for us, we look at our dreams and say, does that mean God's talking to me? If God uses a dream to talk to you and me, you're going to know for certain it's God. If you have the little bitty inkling that it may not be, it's not. So just dismiss it. But these times, God did use dreams to communicate. He communicated to little Joseph two stories. And little Joseph is anxious to tell Dad and the boys what he heard in his dream. Dad, boys, we were all out gathering the wheat. We put them into sheaves. And all of your sheaves bowed down to mine. Whoa, they didn't like that. Second dream, I had another dream. The sun and the moon and the stars all bowed down to me. And his father said, you mean to tell me that me and your mother and your brothers will all bow down to you? Joseph, can't. Put it aside. Well, Jacob didn't put it aside because he was given dreams too. He knows what dreams can do. But the boys, again, another thing, made them hate Joseph even more. So when they're out doing the shepherding, and Jacob sends Joseph out there to test him, the first thing they do is say, let's kill this kid. Let's get rid of this dreamer. That's where that word comes from in the scripture. Let's get rid of this dreamer because of those dreams he had. Well, Judah and Reuben really kind of save his life. And who comes along but Ishmaelites? Catch that word? What are the Ishmaelites? Remember from Abraham, Hagar's son was Ishmael? These were descendants of that Ishmael. And Abraham sent her away, and now the Ishmaelites come and take Joseph away. So it's kind of a tag. And they take him down into Egypt. And when he gets down there, he's really favored. Potiphar is his name. Takes him on as ruler of his household. He does all sorts of things for this man. And Potiphar's wife has eyes on Joseph and would like to have a little more from him than he's ready to give. And so he defends himself. He pulls away from her again and again and again. But this one day, apparently, he got caught. He got cornered. And he scattered out of the house and he forgot his cloak. Well, she's a scorned woman now, so she picks up the cloak and goes to her husband and accuses him, Joseph, of attacking her. And he believes his wife and puts Joseph down in prison. This is all, remember, this is God's leading up to prepare a place for his son to live. And when his son comes, he's preparing a place for us to live. So all of this is one story, and this is our story. Now what happens to poor Joseph? Now he's down in prison again. And down in prison, he meets up with Pharaoh's baker and his butler. And they have dreams. And lo and behold, little Joseph comes, and he interprets the dreams for them. To the baker, he says, your dream tells me that within 3 days, the Pharaoh will cut off your head. And to the butler, he says, your dreams tell me that within 3 days, you will be restored to your duties, and you will again serve the cup to the Pharaoh, which did indeed, in fact, happen. But Joseph told him, he said, now remember, when you're up there, out of this prison, remember me. Tell Pharaoh, you know, what I did for you. He summarily forgot. He just went on with his business until Pharaoh had dreams. And he could find nobody to interpret the dreams. And all of a sudden, the butler said, whoa, wait a minute. Remember when you were mad at me? There's a guy down in prison who knows how to do dreams. Pharaoh says, go get him. So they brought him up, cleaned him up, and presented him to Pharaoh. And he interpreted the dreams to the Pharaoh. Remember, there were 7 ears of corn, beautiful ears of corn, that ended up eating the 7 weak ears of corn. Then there were 7 cows. Beautiful cows that end up eating the 7 thin cows. And Joseph said, here's what God is saying. There's 7 years of plenty coming, followed by 7 years of famine. So you better put aside stuff now so we have enough to sacrifice and enough to eat through the years of famine. Pharaoh was so impressed with that, he raised Joseph up and made him head of the whole country. He had the pocket purse. He did everything. That set up the fact that down in where his father and his brothers lived, they were in famine also. And Jacob heard, you know what? There's a ruler back in Egypt. He's handing out food. Boys, get down there and get some. And so they go down there. Lo and behold, who's giving out the food? But the long-lost brother Joseph that they sold. And they don't recognize him. He understands the Egyptian language, and he understands their language. But they don't understand the Egyptian language. And they don't recognize Joseph as their brother. But he recognizes them. And he kind of makes it a little tough for them to figure this out, that you know, ultimately sold him into slavery. But what it did was, it saved those boys. They saved Jacob and the boys because they moved down to Egypt and they ate. They made it through the famine. And the boys were really chagrined and told their brother Joseph, "We're so sorry we sold you into slavery." Joseph said, "Don't say that. This was God's plan. This is how God got me down here. This is how God got me to be the head thing here. And if it wasn't for me, you guys will all be dead. So God is saving you from what you did." Really a gracious thing that Joseph did for his brothers. All comes around to this thing called faith. We heard the story about faith with Peter today, the whole impulsive Peter. He sees Jesus walking in the water, he says, "Come on, I can walk too, can I, Lord?" "Oh, sure you can, come on." And he goes out there, and as soon as he feels that tent, that water, he's frightened, and he starts to sink because his faith dips. And what's his first word? "Lord, save me." And Jesus reaches out to save him. It's kind of like me. We have that same kind of faith. We're asked to have that same kind of faith. And there's all kinds of people out in that world today who are trying to tell us that our faith is ridiculous. It's a ridiculous story that this guy, Jesus, was killed, was buried, and rose from the dead. Ridiculous. Forget it. You're hearing that on all sides out there. We say no. We hold on to our faith. When our faith wiggles a little bit, we call out to the Lord, "Lord, save me." Reach out our hand, and the Lord will pull us back in. The whole thing, Jesus was sent into that country. It was preserved by all these people that we just went through. The place was preserved for Jesus. Jesus is born there. Now he gives us the message. How are we going to get to the true promised land? How are we going to get to the true place? Moses got him out of slavery. Joshua got him through the Jordan River into the new territory. Now that's set up for Jesus. How are we going to get to the new Jerusalem? And Jesus said, "Believe in me. Just believe. I've come here to take your sins away. All your sins are gone. Forget it. They're gone. Now believe in me." Paul writes it today in the letter to the Romans. This is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's pretty definitive. That's wonderful. That's why we're here. We're here to praise and confess that Jesus is on our lips, that he is Lord. We sing the songs of praise all the time that he is Lord. And we believe in our heart that God raised him from the dead. We are the saved. You are saved. Isn't that a great feeling? I mean, we're saved. Our sins are forgiven. We'll enter the kingdom of heaven with the Lord. That's the faith of the Lord. He also said, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Lord, save me. That's our prayer to the Lord all the time. We are faulty. We are weak. We sin. We continually go back to him. And just like Peter, you know, we're ready to go. And something happens and it's faulty, we raise up again and again, "Lord, save me." And he reaches out, grabs our hand, and pulls us in. "Save us, Lord. We are your people. You loved us, you redeemed us, you forgave us, and now we believe in you, and you will take us into that kingdom forever." What a story.